Thank you for visiting the University of Louisville Journal of Respiratory Infections website. We are going to today discuss our second discussion regarding the topic of clinical research. Today I want to discuss the process of clinical research, step by step from idea to publication. And to start with clinical research, probably let's discuss a little bit of the definitions. As a general consideration, we mentioned that clinical research is defined when we perform research with human subjects. Most of the time in clinical research, investigators have an area of interest. For instance, here in the Division of Infectious Diseases, our area of interest happened to be pneumonia. And when we are doing clinical research, you are interested in creating new knowledge and disseminating new knowledge in an area of interest, in our case would be pneumonia, with the goal to improve the outcomes of the patients in the universe, meaning all the patients with pneumonia all over the world. And this would be a definition of clinical research. Sometimes you read that there is what is called pre-clinical research. And this would be then, this is study in humans, and this pre-clinical research would be when you're in the laboratory, you're studying cells, you're studying tissues, animal research, everything that happened before you go into human research. Then we are concentrated here, clinical research. There is generation or creation and dissemination of new knowledge. Then when we say this generation or creation of a dissemination of new knowledge, and we are going to apply the scientific methodology to generate this new knowledge. This will be a definition of clinical research. If we were to, as we mentioned, we are going to discuss today, step by step from idea to publication. And we can simplify all the process of clinical research in four steps. Then we are going to discuss each one of these steps in this 15 minutes presentation. And the four steps that we are discussing on clinical research will be then step one, planning the study. During this step, we started with an idea. We are going to have a research question. We are going to have all the different study documents, and the outcome of this, the primary outcome of planning the study, is going to be the study protocol. We are going to end it with a study protocol. The second step is going to be performing the study. And we are going to look for patients, we want to enroll patients, we want to do data collection, data quality, and here we are going to end it with a study database. This will be the primary outcome of step two. Step three, analyzing the results. And analyzing the results, we want to do statistical analysis, clinical analysis, and we want to end it with the conclusions. What are going to be the conclusions of our study? And finally, dissemination of a study finding. Here we have the study and we are going to look at presentations, we are going to write abstracts, posters, and we are going to write finally a manuscript for publication in a peer-reviewed journal. Then the four steps of clinical research: planning the study, performing the study, analyzing the study results, dissemination of our study finding. Four steps of clinical research. Then, to finish this 15 minutes presentation, let me just give you a little bit of detail of each one of these steps. Then, in the step one, when we're saying planning the study, I mentioned that there's a lot of study documents that we need to write. And the way to remember these study documents have four questions that we need to address. And the first question is, what do you plan to do? I mean, what is that we plan to do? Remember, we have an idea for research, we have a research question. And then at the beginning, when we have a research question, some people say, well, you're going to start discussing your research question with your colleagues to see, to get feedback. And the best way to get feedback, you change your research question. It was defined sometimes at the study outline or the letter of intent, that this is just two pages that you just put, this is my idea, this is my research question, this is the hypothesis that I have, this is how do I plan to do the study, inclusion criteria, exclusion criteria, how do I plan to do my statistical analysis, and then what do I think that's going to be my results, and how's going to be the impact of this in the outcomes, how do I want to plan to improve the outcomes of the patients in the universe. This is just two pages that you write. You start giving this around to start getting some feedback. These two pages are going to keep growing as you get feedback into 5, 10, 15 pages, and you're going to end up having the full study protocol. Then the study protocol answers the question, what do you plan to do? This is my study protocol. So I said there are four questions in planning the study. The first question is, what do you plan to do? And this is going to start with a study outline, and it's going to finish with your study protocol. Then this is in the study protocol. Step by step, what do you plan to do? The second question is, how are you going to do it? See, now, I plan to, in the protocol, you may say, I plan to get an oropharyngeal swab to get PCR for atypical pathogens. Fine, this is what you want to do. How are you going to do it? Sometimes this is called standard operating procedures, or we call it the study manual. Then the manual of operations. Then we are going to get this type of swab. It's going to be a colon swab. The patient is going to open the mouth. We are going to go to the back of the oropharynx. We are going to swab. Then essentially you're going to specifically say how you're going to do it. In the protocol, sometimes the protocol says, well, we're going to enroll patients with fever. Well, what is going to be your definition of fever? It's going to be what level? That is going to be here. The study manual is the tape and the tail. Is the standard operating procedures. The next question is, how much is going to cost? And this, of course, is going to be your study budget. Now, some people say, well, this is an unfunded study. This is, I don't have a budget. Well, it doesn't matter if you have a budget or not. Every clinical research is going to have a cost. Now, the cost is that your time or whatever you're going to be doing. And someone, we have to be paying for this. Oh, I'm just going to get 20 patients and red blood and we're going to do cytokines. Who's going to pay for the kits? Well, I don't have a budget. But someone, then the question is even your time. Then it's good to have the practice of whatever you're doing, or we have a budget that this is going to be paid by the hospital, by the university, by your own division, who is going to have the time, who's going to allow you to have the time to do the research. Then, of course, you're going to go for funding, and your protocol is going to, you're going to submit your protocol for funding. Then cabinet, the budget is critical, because if you're going to ask for funding, you have to have a very detailed budget to figure out how are you going to spend the money. Finally, another important question is, are you allowed to do it? And nowadays, in research, it doesn't matter what you're going to do, you always have to question, I'm allowed to do it. Meaning that here, we have all the regulatory documents and all the, essentially, the documents that have to do with the IRB of your institution, IRB or your hospital, the institutional review board. And some people say that, again, I've been doing clinical research for a long time. And I remember years ago when, oh, this is an interesting case. Oh, let's write a case report. You write a case report, send it to a journal, and this was all done internally in your own division. This is no longer the case. Even if you want to write a case report form, you need to ask permission to see if you are going to be allowed to do a case report form. Then essentially for anything, you need to have approval to do any form of research. Now, it may be that the approval may be a simple, oh yes, you can do it, or maybe more complicated. Then four questions when you are planning the study. What do you plan to do? Are you going to have a detailed study protocol? How are you going to do it? Are you going to have a detailed study manual with all the steps? How much is it going to cost? You're going to have a detailed budget. And are you allowed to do it? Everything has to do with the ethics and regulatory documents. Then you have to be sure that all the documents are in order. All these, the protocol, the manual, the budget, the regulatory, the IRB, all these put together sometimes is defined as the grant proposal. Because essentially when you go and you want to request funding for your research, then the grant proposal, the protocol is just one document among all these documents. Now sometimes if this is going to be again, unfunded studies, you're going to review 30 medical records to see what happened with patients with pneumonia and the level of CRP and correlate. Well, you may say, well, this, but you still need to have a protocol, you still need to have your study manual, you still need to, I suggest, you need to have a budget because this may be sponsored by your own division, but someone has to put money because time is money, even though it is a retrospective case report, and then you always need to know that you're going to be allowed to go to the medical record and look at the history of the patient and review the cases, because essentially when the time arrives that you want to submit anything for publication, any journal is going to ask you for your documents, for your IRB number that you were allowed to do this research. Planning the study. This is step one of clinical research. Now we're going to move to step two, that is performing the study. Okay. Now we're moving to the step two, that would be performing the study. Every aspect of clinical research, every step is critical. This is extremely critical, performing the study. And here, there are different elements that, for instance, in performing the study, we are going to need to find the patients for our clinical research. We are going to enroll the patients. This may be, it is a prospective study, you may need to have a consent form. This is retrospective study, you may not need to have a consent form. We are going to enroll patients in the trial. We are going to follow the patients over time, again, maybe prospective or retrospective. And after you start collecting all the information, finally you're going to do your data quality to see how good is the data that you've been collecting in the patients, once you finish your data quality, and all this performing the study, as I mentioned, all this information is going to be entered into the study database. To the study database. Then at the end of the day, we did all the planning. We write the protocol, study manual, the budget, we have all the regulatory documents. We performed the study, we went to find patients, well, we did a review of the medical record, we enrolled the patient, we follow, we do data quality, we sure that everything's okay. And step one plus step two get all summarized in your database. Then your study database is a critical element because all the step one and step two is going to enter in your database. This is why I say that is critical, and also at the beginning, when you start going your study protocol, your study manual, that you're going to be working on what is going to be your database. Because this is the only thing that you're going to have that's going to summarize all the efforts of step one and step two. Then everything is going to be in your database. Now, once you finish having your database, you're going to be ready to start with the next step that's going to be the analysis. Now, let me also mention that writing the study documents and performing the study, you're doing a prospective study. This may take several months to write in the documents. This may take also several months, 1 year or more, to collect all the patients. Then when you end up with a database in a prospective study, you're already probably at year two of your clinical research. Then what is the meaning of this? This means that to get into a database, I need to have at least 2 years of time. You may say, well, I don't have 2 years, because in 2 years, I need to be doing something. I'm going to be doing a residency program. I want to be a fellow in this program, but my fellowship is going to be 2 years. If it's going to take me 2 years to have my database, what when I going to do the step three and the step four? Well, what are the alternatives? Then let me discuss. This would be the traditional approach. This would be a primary study. But let me discuss alternatives that are there to save time in clinical research. Then, if we want to shorten the time to perform clinical research, we mentioned that if we are doing the primary study, we are doing the planning, we have all the documents, we perform the study, collect all the patients, 1 + 2 is going to be in the study database. Now, this what is called ancillary studies. An ancillary study is that you arrive to a place and you know that, for instance, they are doing a pneumonia study, and they are collecting cases, and they are doing a prospective study, and everything is working in this primary study. And then you have a research question that you want to add to the study that is already ongoing. Then you plan, you do the planning for your research question. You have your research question, you have your protocol, and they're already collecting patients of pneumonia, and there's a consent form, but you are interested to see is the patient with pneumonia, when they have an outcome, if the mortality is correlated to the C-reactive protein. One laboratory test. Now, someone is already doing the study. You have this, and you add this essentially to the performing of the study. Then what you have here is you add a little bit into the data collection, and someone is already at the funding, someone is doing the study, you add something to a study that is ongoing. This should be an ancillary study. This is very common. Then whenever we develop a full study and we get funding for one study, we're immediately thinking, okay, what are the ancillary studies we can apply to this study? Because these studies are going to be essentially very effective because the study is already going. When you arrive to a place, you figure out someone is doing a study, and you figure out you can develop an ancillary study. Now, another possibility is what is called secondary data analysis. Here, an investigator that was funded with a primary study did the planning, did the performance of the study, and they had the database. You learn what is in the database, and essentially, you do the planning here. You do your planning with your research question, and you ask the question directly to the database. And essentially what you're doing here is that you have a question that is going to be addressed with a database. Because the advantage here is that when we're doing clinical research with a primary study, we collect a lot of data. There is a lot of data in every database. And the investigator have a primary objective, sometimes secondary objective, maybe one, two, three, four primary questions. But there's a lot of data in every database that you can ask further questions to a database. This should be secondary data analysis. Then essentially here, you just go directly to a database. Then speed, minimal amount of time, very economic, doing ancillary studies and doing secondary data analysis. To do this, if you arrive to a place, you need to figure out who is doing clinical research and in which team I can be already working. And for here, for planning, you add something to the data collection form, you still have the performing. It's going to be several months, 1 year. In secondary data analysis, you go directly to a database. Then, we did the step one, we planned, we did the step two, we performed the study, went with the database. Now let's move to step three. Okay, then it's time to analyze your study results. In the database, you have your question, the database give you an answer, give you the results. But now we need to analyze. How do we analyze the results? There are two types of analysis that we always perform. The statistical analysis, and the clinical analysis. The statistical analysis, we perform it ourselves, work with our statisticians, you get the results, and you're going to have the classical statistical test. Just to mention, for instance, in the statistical analysis, of course, we are going to get the p-value, the odds ratios, the relative risk. You may do a multivariate analysis, a time-to-event analysis, and these are all the common statistical tests that we're going to be discussing in the future, that then you're going to see is your results, how are the consideration for your results, what are the possibility of chance may explain your results, or bias, or confounding, how close your results are going to be to the truth, that whatever you find in your database after planning and performing is correlated with the patients in the universe. Then we're going to do the clinical analysis. The clinical analysis, you look at the data, and there are several characteristics that I'm going to discuss another time, but for instance, now how consistent is my results with whatever is in the literature? Is this something that follows whatever is in the literature? What is the biological plausibility? What I found in my results, can I make sense of this? Do I have a pathophysiology that can explain my results based on what I know regarding this particular disease? And at the end of the day, you may have something that is very significant from the statistical analysis, the p-value may be very low, but from the clinical analysis, what is the clinical importance? At the end of the day is how important is going to be your findings, how these findings is going to improve the outcomes of the patients in the universe. Then you do your statistical analysis, you do your clinical analysis, and what you ended in this step three is with your conclusion. You're going to have your study conclusion. Then analysis, you're going to say, okay, yes, I think that my conclusion is that this study is telling me this is the answer to my question, and this is going to affect the outcomes of the patients in the universe, every patient with pneumonia. Because remember that when you are doing your study, you're trying to come out with conclusions, not just for the 50 patients you're studying. Your conclusion is for all the patients in the universe. We are trying to clinical research, creation and dissemination of new knowledge with the idea to improve the outcome of the patients in the universe. Then analysis of the results, statistical analysis, clinical analysis. Step one, two and three, planning, performing analysis. This is the way that we create new knowledge. Step four, dissemination. Then, in step four, disseminating your study findings. Since, by definition, research is the creation or dissemination of new knowledge, in the first step, we created the new knowledge, and now we're going to disseminate. As I mentioned, we disseminate by giving presentations with our findings. We write abstracts, we write posters, but the primary way to disseminate study findings is to a peer review publication, because peer review is part of the scientific process. Then essentially, and to have a peer review publication, you need to write your manuscript. And in every group, we are going to have, what we need to have is a writing group. Then you're going to have a writing group that's going to be part of your research group. And this writing group, then you write your manuscript, version one of your manuscript. And you have version one of your manuscript, you send it to the study group. They give you feedback, and you write version two. You send it to a study group, they give you feedback, you write version three. And then it's going to be several versions until you finally, your manuscript is going to be ready to be submitted to a journal. Then you're going to submit to a journal, most likely it's going to be rejected, but then you resubmit to a journal and you follow the reviewer's comments, and then finally, you're going to end it with a publication. And there are large number of presentations, how to write a manuscript, because you have to be successful. One thing that we follow that is in plenty of articles regarding publication is the KISS principle that is applied in a lot of things that we do. Then keep it short, keep it simple, then everything that we write in science has to be short and has to be simple. And the other thing is also, it has to be logic, it has to follow a logic. Then we need to keep it simple, keep it short. We're not writing a novel. We're not writing something that's supposed to be difficult. It's supposed to be simple and short. The problem is for our writing to be simple, short, and logical, we need several versions to be sure that we're going to have the right idea plus in a manuscript that's going to be published. And this will be for disseminate your study findings. Then we are going to have a publication, and this publication is going to be in a peer review journal, meaning that it's going to be accepted by your peers. Then we started with an idea. I have an idea that I would like to do research. With this idea, I have my research question. I want to plan the study. Then I want to perform the study. Then it's going to finish in the database. I want to do the analysis of my results, statistical analysis and clinical analysis. And once I have my conclusions, I want to write a manuscript and I want to end it with a publication. And this will be, we discuss today, step by step from idea to publication of the process of clinical research. Thank you very much.